بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اولا انا بعتذر ان انا رجعت تاني. انا كنت عايز ازوغ بس ما عرفتش، بس اوعدكم دي اخر مره، يعني ان شاء الله تشوفوني النهارده، يعني ان شاء الله على خير بكره بقى. طيب انا بشكر الدكتور بشكر الدكتور عبد السلام طبعا، بعد يعني عشان النهارده في اخر اليوم، يعني الراجل بصراحه عامل مجهود كبير جدا جدا، وانا بحييه هو والدكتور شريف الزواوي على اللي هم عاملينه، وما كنتش متصور بصراحة ان هم في الوقت القصير ده يقدروا يعملوا الشغل العظيم ده، بس ده مش غريب على الدكتور عبد السلام والدكتور شريف الزواوي، فانا فعلا بحييهم، ارجوكم تحييهم معايا يعني. ربنا يبارك فيكم. First I'd like to thank Novartis Pharmaceutical for giving me the opportunity, and my talk today will be about the Monalisa trials, the CD46 inhibitors of Novartis, which is the ribociclib or Kisqali. Okay, so let's start. We already know that Kisqali has a consistent, rapid, and substantial efficacy regardless of combination partner or menopausal status. We know that it works very well in premenopausal and postmenopausal, and it's the only CD46 inhibitor that has a dedicated trial for premenopausal women, which is Monalisa 7. Okay? Yes, other trials included some premenopausal patients with abemaciclib and palbociclib, but it's not a dedicated trial, very well designed, like the trial of ribociclib of Novartis. So let's start by Monalisa 2, which actually got the approval for ribociclib, where postmenopausal patient with hormone responsive tumors, HER2 negative, okay, with advanced breast cancer with no prior therapy. This is a first line, okay? Disease or de novo after 12 months of adjuvant treatment were randomized to receive Kisqali, the usual 3 weeks on, 1 week off, plus letrozole. انا بس هستاذن حضرتك معلش عشان ممكن الصوت بس بعد اذنك لو سمحت. اوكي فيرسس بلاسيبو اند لتروزول. سو دوز بيشنت وور ريسيفينج كاسكالي سي دي 46 انهيبيتور وذ هرمونال كومبانيون لتروزول. اي جس ايفريبادي نوز واتس لتروزول اند فيرسس لتروزول الون اند ذا برايمري بروجريشن فري سيرفايفل وذ ذا برايمري اند بوينت وذ بلنتي سيكندري اند بوينتس اند اكتشولي ذا كيرف سبيكس فور اتس سيلف. يو هاف سمثينج لايك a median progression-free survival of 25 months, a clear difference between using and not using Kisqali, and this is actually the largest first-line AI combination study in postmenopausal women. This is impressive. Okay? Most importantly, as I don't know if you have been there in the last session for CD46 inhibitor, and this is a consistent finding for all CD46 inhibitor. You have a rapid response, exactly like chemotherapy, if the patient is responding. I'm not saying that all patients. So you see that here, almost within 8 weeks, you have the effect of the CD46 inhibitor. So it's something like two cycles of chemotherapy that the usual we go, unless you have a visceral crisis, by the way. I mean, you are not allowed to use this line of treatment when you have visceral crisis, okay? These are the figures. Then we move to the second line, which is Monalisa 3, phase 3 trial, where again, 2-to-1 randomization. Now we have confidence in the drug. That's why we included more patients in the arm of Kisqali. Now plus fulvestrant, again, postmenopausal women, second line treatment versus placebo fulvestrant, and progression-free survival was the primary endpoint. And still, you have an 8 clear months difference. You don't expect the high as the first line, because this is a second line. These are more resistant disease, mostly acquired resistance, but the class effect is there. The benefit of CD46 ribociclib is there. It's superior to fulvestrant alone with, again, rapid separation of the curves within 8 weeks, which is very impressive. Okay? This is actually the first data analysis of median progression-free survival, telling us that the Kisqali fulvestrant median progression-free survival was not reached, as opposed to only 18.3 months for no fulvestrant. And you see thereafter, it was 33.6 as opposed to 16.5. This is more than double median progression-free survival. In the second line setting, you look actually with a median progression-free survival of 18 months versus 11, a clear 7 months, a very convincing hazard ratio of 0.53, which means that half of the patient do benefit from that treatment, and you can see by the separation of the curve. Okay, this is in second line and early relapse setting. Let's go into early relapse setting. After 2 years of adjuvant, you will find also a difference with a median progression-free survival of 13 now to 8.6 months. Again, these are more difficult patients. You see that the, as long as you go for more difficult patients, the response is less and the difference is less. However, it's still there superior. You are gaining for your patient. And the effect for Kisqali or the CD46 inhibitor was consistent in all subgroup analysis. You just name it from the left hand side of the slide. Okay? Time to subsequent chemotherapy, which is actually very important. Every single patient you treat in the clinic is asking you this question. Will I receive chemotherapy thereafter? Because she's already has received it most probably in the adjuvant setting, and she's very worried to go again and receive chemotherapy, and she's asking that. This is one of the challenges of Kisqali. Patients have a longer time to the second chemotherapy if they need it. They might not need it, okay? And actually, if you see, there is 30% reduction in the progression to chemotherapy as opposed to no Kisqali. You see here the overall response rate or the objective response rate and clinical benefit rate definitely in favor of Kisqali as per the left and right side hand of the slide. You see the waterfall plot showing definitely higher response for the use of Kisqali as in the upper part of the curve with fulvestrant as compared to fulvestrant alone. So actually, we have very consistent data. The percentage change in the tumor size from baseline, either in all patients or in patients with liver metastasis, those are the hardest to treat, still there in favor of Kisqali. More decrease in the tumor size using Kisqali. So the Mona Lisa study design, as I already mentioned, was there. Now we're looking into, we've moved from progression-free survival into a new endpoint, which is overall survival. Again, these are the data disposition. The patients were followed up for a longer period, 39.4 months. And this is actually, it's not only by the way ribociclib, but this is the first time we've seen difference in metastatic hormone positive patients in terms of overall survival. Okay, with anti-estrogen, with fulvestrant alone, with all AIs, we've seen only progression-free survival. This is the first time in the class effect by CD46 inhibitors that we see overall survival data. You can see here that the hazard ratio is 0.72, meaning 28% do benefit. And you see actually that the median overall survival was not reached in the Mona Lisa 3 trial, but it's there. You look on the left-hand side in the first line, in the early relapse and the second line, the effect of Kisqali is there. However, you still wait for even better than 40.2 months in the early relapse and second line as the first line, and you expect that would be higher as it's not been reached yet in terms of overall survival. It's definitely more than 45 months, so more than 2 years in overall survival, not only progression-free survival. Even in patients with visceral metastasis, the data was very consistent, and you can see actually the hazard ratio of 0.8, now you have 20% improvement for the addition of Kisqali, and that's already been seen in the Mona Lisa 7, the premenopausal, with a higher magnitude of benefit, now 30% as per the hazard ratio. So again, very consistent data. And also that was updated in the ASCO 2020, showing us even more benefit with liver metastasis now is 60.62, now it's 38%, okay? And again, the same for the Mona Lisa 7 premenopausal patients, it's almost half of the patients did benefit if they have even liver metastasis. So I mean, as long as the patient do not have visceral crisis, don't be afraid to use it. Even they have lung metastasis, they have bone metastasis, they have liver metastasis, as long as there is no visceral crisis, as per all guidelines, you are allowed to use this line of treatment. And you can see again, the exploratory analysis was observed in all exploratory subgroup. Now, patients care a lot about their quality of life, and you can see that the quality of life scores is very well maintained with the use of Kisqali versus no Kisqali, and the time to deterioration is more than 10% in fatigue and pain was maintained in both treatment arms. I mean, so Kisqali did not add to the toxicity profile of fulvestrant, so, and there was no safety signals that were reported in both overall survival interim analysis. So we have consistent data in progression-free survival, very consistent data in overall survival with a very well tolerated and drug and very good toxicity profile. Now we move to, this is actually the safety. I will not go through that details. I already mentioned that, and these are the summary and the conclusions. Now we go into a little bit of a real-world data. Now, all the clinical data we present in the trials are the ones that are done under very meticulous guidelines within a clinical trial. You know that clinical trials are very meticulous. You have to do so and so and so and so. But in the real life, when we prescribe such medication to our patients, we really do would like to know what is the results with the real life. Is it really like the trials or not? This is very important because this is what's really meaningful to us and to our patients. What's the complement trial? This is a one single arm, but a phase 3B trial. For men and women, by the way, Kiskali is good for men, by the way. Hormone responsive tumor, HER2 negative. No prior endocrine therapy and less than or equal to one chemotherapy line. Good performance status, adequate bone marrow and organ function with no changes in the QTC interval. They are subjected to the usual ribo, 600 milligrams, 3 weeks on, 1 week off. Okay. And our primary endpoint was to look at the safety and tolerability, because this matters a lot to our patient, and then look at the secondary endpoints, time to progression, overall response rate, clinical benefit rate, and others. These are the characteristics of the patients. This is a huge number of patients, 3,246 patients. The safety results are quite assuring. Most common all-grade adverse events were neutropenia that you really expect, but I mean, I'm not speaking for out of nothing. I have a limited experience, and many other researchers do have more. It's not a real problem with neutropenia. I've never seen febrile neutropenia with the use of CD46 inhibitor. So, and it goes on its own, by the way, but you have to follow your patient carefully, and you usually don't need a growth factor for this. So really don't be worried from that. So we're talking about neutropenia. The instance of the change in QTC interval, actually, that was in that trial 1.8, but collectively speaking, it was less than 1%. And how meaningful is that? We really don't know. Because it's there. It's a finding that you find on the ECG when you measure the QTC interval. Yes, but is it meaningful? Is it not? We don't really know. Okay? So actually, this is quite safe, and the efficacy results are there to tell us actually that the median time to progression was more than 2 years, and the progression-free survival is 26.7 months. Again, these are very similar to what we have been seeing in the Mona Lisa trials in the trials. Okay, this is actually the conclusions. In patients with hormone-responsive HER2 advanced breast cancer with no prior endocrine therapy, the use of ribo plus letrozole demonstrated acceptable safety and sustained efficacy. Okay? Now, this is a very nice piece of paper that was presented in the last ASCO. Okay? This is a pooled analysis of all the Mona Lisa trials. Mona Lisa 2, 3, and 7. Okay? So this is a huge number of patients. And with different first line and second line, postmenopausal and premenopausal, they're there to put all the patients and analyze them, trying to find out if there are any biomarkers, whether genetic pathways or whatever, to guide us to use or not to use this type of treatment in our patients. Okay? So they were pooling the circulating DNA, increasing the sample size and power. The current reports analyzes pooled circulating DNA from Mona Lisa trials to identify potential biomarkers of response or resistance to the ribociclib CD46 inhibitor. These actually are the trials, T2, 3, and 7. Actually, these are the numbers. The primary endpoints were all progression-free survival. Good numbers, around 700 in every single trial. Sorry. This is actually the methodology when they used next-generation sequencing, and also circulating DNA from plasma samples were sequenced using the following. I mean, these are all details. I guess lab people will elaborate on that. I'm not qualified to do that. However, they looked into the genes with frequency more than 2%, with more than 15 in more than 15 patients in any arm included, and these are the baseline characteristics of the patients. بعد إذنك بس هتديني دقيقتين مثلاً. أنا ربط خلص. Okay. بعد إذنك دكتور عبد السلام. Okay. These are the baseline characteristics of the patients, and the median progression-free survival when you pool the analysis was more or less the same. You find actually the same hazard ratio, namely 40-something or almost half of the patients do benefit from the treatment. Now, for the findings, The potential biomarkers for response are the following. These are all, I'm not very familiar to these names, but these are the genes FRS2, MDM2. I only know the BRCA and the ERBB, by the way, but the others I really don't know. And these are the level of significance. This is significant, 0.02, approaching significance, significant, significant, approaching significance, and not significant. Those are the potential biomarkers for response to ribocyclib. And these are associated with ribocyclib decreased efficacy, the CHD4, ATM, which is already known from before, and the CDKN2A. These are, on the other side, are not working on our side or our patient's side. The genes that are implicated in the literature that are potential resistance mechanism for endocrine therapy and or CD46 inhibitor, we already know the P10, we already know the retinoblastoma, and the NF1. How much valuable are these data? I'm not sure. Nobody is sure. But I mean, it's one step ahead. We need really, because all of the CD46 inhibitors trying to find biomarkers to guide us to give or not to give this drug or that drug has every time failed. Even the palbociclib is the first CD46 inhibitor that was approved, and was approved in February 2015 on a phase 2 trial. And that trial was divided, by the way. Half of the trial was with biomarker, and half was without biomarker. And they could not identify a single biomarker that would help us and give us a guidance. So actually, these data are very encouraging, but you cannot put them in the guidelines. You cannot use them, actually, and it's very meticulous to use them. You have to do gene profiling for all the patients, which is very tedious. You cannot do that on daily clinical practice. However, maybe one time point, our junior colleagues will have that in their hands. They will have something like a scoring system, would tell them that this patient will respond to the treatment in 70%, 20%, or whatever. Hopefully, you will see this coming. Thank you so much.